This one's a very small hatch to get in.
All in. Made that look easy.
Yep. First engine, and this is a fuel pump. I've got that hooked on a relay. There we go.
The M5 came out at about April 1942, where it went into production. So they built roughly about 2,074 of this particular model before they went to the A1 with the slightly different turret. This is where we saw a change in hull design from the M3. So instead of having that step front, now we have a slope front. So this is at about 48 degrees. The thickness of the armour comes in at about 28.8 millimetres thick. At 48 degrees, gives us about 42 millimetres line of sight thickness on the front. So still very lightly armoured, but for its role, especially in a reconnaissance role, being lighter, it was very quick. Have the driver on this side, he also has a windshield, two little sockets here. They're welded in at the moment, but these were an emergency vision port. So if their periscopes get taken out by fragmentation or fire, they can generally pop these out and they can use their Mark 1 eyeball to actually see where they're going. It's not till we get to the M5A1 where the turret changes. We've got an elongated bustle and a cover for the 30 caliber as well. 37mm gun, so even by 1942, this gun was pretty much obsolete. But when we get into, say, the Southwest Pacific area of operations, the 37mm along with the British 2-pounder could still sort of take on the Japanese. Secondary armament, we've got the M1919A5 machine gun. A primary difference between these two 30 caliber machine guns, being the A4 and the A5, was when they put the A4 in that gun mount that they found that the gunner couldn't cock the weapon. So that to change the new cocking device in there, and the hold open device had to be changed. So we've got two different variations of the 30 caliber machine gun. They generally carry about just over 6,000 rounds between all three, because there was another one that sat on the commander's cupola as well. 123 rounds were carried on board for the 37. So for a small light tank doing a reconnaissance job, still had a little bit of punch, but it wasn't what I would call a direct fire weapon. It's more of a defensive weapon. If somebody's shooting at you, fire and get out of dodge. With this vehicle in particular, we have the metal chevron track. It actually says on the tech manual to change from steel track to rubber track at the earliest opportunity. Obviously with rubber track, gives you that longevity, a little bit quieter as well. Even though steel track is cheaper to produce, it was in the tech manual to change these tracks. This one, when we change the hull design, we go to fully welding. And this is carried all the way along. As we see here, this raised portion here, because this had the twin V8 Cadillac engines, and between them gives you about 220 horsepower. So this was raised to allow for room for those engines. As we've seen now, Ryan's put the twin 350 Chevs in there. So we've gone from about 220 horsepower in the original configuration to about 666 horsepower between the two engines. These ones were the first to come out with the automatic gearbox as well, along with the Chaffee. So with the automatic gearbox, the driver training requirement actually went down, so it didn't take as long to train the drivers. On the back of the vehicle, with every tank, you generally have pioneer tools. The most important one, our track adjusting tool, used in conjunction with our track adjusters here. So you undo the nut and you can use the track adjusting tools and you can wind it in and out. In the tech manual, it says that the track sag between the first and second guide rollers should be about 3/4 inch, about 19 mil, to be at its correct tension. On the back of the turret, we have grousers. So as we can probably see at the back, we have steel track, which we wouldn't use grousers for because there's no requirement. But on the side here, we do have the rubber track. Now those grousers actually fit in the pins just in here. So it gives you extra traction when going through mud, snow, ice, and that sort of thing. Because we've changed the design of the front of the hull, the steering levers are actually on a bar that sits quite high up. So he's actually pulling down on his levers, where if we go to the M3, we've got the tillers that are connected to the floor and you're actually pulling up the turn. So we took it for a test drive yesterday. So it sounds and drives really great. So if you want to ride on this vehicle, come to Oz Armor Fest 2023, click on the links below and get your tickets.